Recently, I was made aware of a movement within the Amish system whereby they were practicing witchcraft and, in fact, Satanism. I'll define that here in just a couple minutes. But I was made aware of this, and it was interesting because growing up in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania, my family, the Denlinger family, originally Denklinger in Germany, but Bavaria, when we came to America, a lot of the Denlingers changed it from Denklinger to Denlinger, but our family goes way back in Lancaster County. Okay, so I'm definitely a native of Lancaster County. I live in Maine now. I moved here, but from Lancaster County, and a lot of my neighbors were Amish. My grandparents were Mennonites, so and on back through. So I do know what I'm talking about. If you haven't seen the other Amish exposed videos, you can watch those. But I heard a lot of things growing up, and I saw things growing up, and a lot of it just didn't make sense. It just was kind of like, well, it's just the way it is because I'm raised here in Lancaster County. This is the way it is, and didn't really think much of it. And as I've gotten older, when I got saved, when I was 25 years old, and I started to study a lot and research a lot, I started to realize how wicked Lancaster County was and how wicked a lot of the Amish system was. And I had heard this term powwowing, and I always used to think it's so strange that Amish would talk about powwow and stuff like this, because I thought, well, they're not Native American. Native American do the powwow thing, and I'm like going, this doesn't make any sense to me. And you just kind of, when you're raised around evil and things, a lot of times you just kind of push those things off into the back part of your mind and say, I don't know what it means. I don't know if there's any significance, so I just forget about it. Recently, as I've been doing some research, the Lord opened up my eyes to this whole thing. And it's not just the Amish that this ties in with. It ties in with a bunch of other things that we'll be talking about today. Now, I, as a Bible-believing preacher, I classify witchcraft and Satanism this way. Witchcraft, in my classification, and they would even argue amongst themselves on this, witches will mostly use sort of elements of nature and things like that to affect certain spells and things. And there's more incantations and spell casting, and like they'll get into using different formulas and stuff like this to make things happen. Where I would call it Satanism is when they get into actual blood rituals. And I realize that there are witches that do blood rituals, and that some of the whole thing is just a mess created by Satan, okay? Any witch is eventually going to become a Satanist if they're lusting for power. That's just a fact, all right? That's why the Bible condemns witchcraft and any practices involved with that whole system. We'll be looking at those scriptures in this study today. There's no way to Christianize it, okay? Remember that. But a lot of witches that are low level, Wiccans and things like this, most of those would not get into some of the stuff that I'm going to be showing you today in this study. There's some very dark, very disturbing things. And again, the Amish. The reason I'm so much opposed to the Amish system, having been raised around it and seeing it, is because it is a system that they put up a very nice front, and behind it there are so many dark secrets, and there are children being hurt, there are animals being hurt. I'm not an animal rights activist, I'm not a vegetarian, I don't think it's unethical to eat meat or something, no. But I do also understand that animals are a creation of God, and when you have people being very, very cruel and torturing animals, that's a problem. That's a big problem. I have a very, very big issue with that. I know that being in Lancaster County, back when I was there, there was a big movement underway to stop the puppy mills in Lancaster County. And again, I've been around those things. I've seen them. They'll put these little, small little cages. I mean, the dog's just like sitting in there, has enough room to eat and defecate and sleep, kind of. It's atrocious. I have a sister, and she's got a yellow lab, I guess, dog. And the poor thing, anytime she sees a man, she'll just like quiver, and she just will shake, and she'll actually start to, urinate on the ground because she's so scared. See, she's a puppy mill dog, and so she was raised with an Amish man that would beat the little puppies and beat these dogs mercilessly. And I've seen them with horses and things like this. They're very, very cruel, sadistic people. And again, I understand people are going to say, not all Amish are that way. Yes, but this, you see, there are many that are, and the ones that aren't are covering up for the ones that are. And there's this system of secrecy, and don't you dare say anything, it's going to get the other Amish in trouble and things. And so they're putting up with it. It'd be very similar to somebody being arrested that was driving a car for bank robbers. You say, well, he didn't rob the bank. Yeah, but he's driving the car for the bank robbers. You see, you're a criminal by implication. You're brought in because you're helping other criminals. And that's what the Amish system is. The Amish system should be obliterated. Just going to say it right now. Okay? And that's what I'm going to, you know, I can't say I'm going to work towards it because I got so many other things to do. But I'd love to see it, the day come when there are no more Amish. People want to live off grid, live without electricity? Fine, no problem. But get rid of this stinking organized religion system where people are telling you what you can and cannot do with your own personal hygiene, with the way you cut your beard, wear your hair, cut your hair, wear your hat, your clothing, whatever else. That stuff is totally foreign to scripture, all right? The whole Amish system is corrupt. It is a satanic system. And I'm going to show you today that it truly is satanic. All right? Now I'm going to show you two books. First of all, this one right here. I'm going to show you in detail on the overhead camera. This is an old book, a little booklet from 1973. All right? Very interesting stuff. Let me show you this thing here. Here we have the front cover here in German. This is what it would have looked like in 1820, the original print of The Long Lost Friend there. If you don't speak German, you aren't going to understand that. John George Hohmann from Berks County, Pennsylvania. All right, 1820 was when this thing was originally written. And here, excuse my head there, here's the book. Right here, we're going to be looking at this book in just a little bit of time, The Long Lost Friend by Hohmann. This is a old copy, just about a 100-year-old copy. It was very expensive, but let me show you inside here. Okay, hexerei, practice of witchcraft among the Pennsylvania Dutch. And I'm aware it's not all just the Amish. There's probably some Mennonites messing with this stuff too and things, but I saw these things growing up and I always thought it was kind of gross. I always hated snakes and I thought, what's the deal? Why would you have a serpent coiled around a thing there, a cane or whatever? And a seven-swirled hex cane with snake design gives its owner supernatural power. It's printed in 1973. We're just going to go through this thing real quickly. There's an original cut from the Hohmann's book there with this magical formula here. Hexerei, a practice of witchcraft. Let me zoom in a little bit better here so you can really get a good look at this. From the earliest years of the 18th century to the present day, hexerei has remained an underground belief and practice. Only in recent years has enough evidence been collected to present an introductory study. As in the rest of Western civilization, there has existed and does exist among the Dutch a belief in black and white magic. The art of white magic is in the Dutch country is referred to as brokkerij, or popularly as powwowing. Hexerei, of course, is the art of black magic. Powers used to heal in the art of brokkerij are derived from God. No, they are not. The Holy Trinity. But the powers employed in hexerei are derived from the devil. Right? Absolute total lie. That's not true. God is not going to give anybody witchcraft powers. That's a lie. The Pennsylvania Dutch witch. These persons are ordinary country folk, but for some reason have chosen to enter a contract with the devil for supernatural powers. We're going to see how to get into that contract here in just a minute. In accordance to folk tradition, there are several ways for a person to become a hex witch. Nearly all of the methods require the prospective witch to renounce God and in this way accept the leadership of the devil. Now watch how the three different ways to do this here. Number one, to become a hex, take a black cat and boil it alive in a kettle of hot water. When the bones and flesh have boiled apart, take a skimming ladle and collect all the bones with it. Take these bones to a nearby stream, place them in the water, all what will sink but one. The bone that does not sink will come to the top of the water and float upstream against the current. When this has been done, that person will be able to hex. Number two, if you wish to become a witch, go to the cow stable and fetch a manure hook. Thereafter, climb to the top of a large pile of manure in the barnyard. Standing on top of this mound, swing the hook three times over your head and repeat the following. There you go. After performing this simple ceremony, the devil will give you the power to hex. If you are really sincere and wish to be a witch, go to the kitchen and draw a large circle on the floor with a piece of coal. Then step inside the circle and hold your hand out. The devil will come and make his mark in the palm of your hand. After this acceptance, you will be a hex. A dried turtle dove tongue used in a love potion. Right there. Okay, now, do I believe that that stuff can actually happen? Well, I believe that when you start to mess around with that type of thing, that you are going to get in contact with the spirit world. I think that there is some definite power there, and cursing and hexing and things like this among lost people, which the Amish certainly are lost people. So, yes, there is some of that stuff going on there. I as a Christian, I believe that witches and things can do things to oppress a Christian, but they can never possess you. They can never kill you. Right? That's important to understand there. Witches are powerless in the presence of God Almighty. And God Almighty is not going to give any witch power. All right, that's something that's just, this whole system of powwowing and things like that is ridiculous. They're not getting it from God. And I'm going to show you, actually, it goes back to Roman Catholicism. I'm not joking, okay? Just kind of spoil it a little bit here. The man's name was Albertus Magnus. He lived in the 13th, well, born right around the late 1100s, 1193 or so, right in that area, up to about 1200 AD, somewhere in there. And they lived up through the early part of and up into the mid 13th century. And he was a professor of Thomas Aquinas. So this guy was a high-level occultist. I'm going to show you the proof. He's the actual author of The Long-Lost Friend. Again, I'm going to show you that. Very, very wicked man. Extremely wicked. And again, this is another tie-in. We're going to be showing more proof of this in the future, that the Amish system is actually a branch of monasticism under the system of Catholicism. All right. That's all it is. It is not a Christian faith, a Christian system, or whatever else. Not at all. They are monastic Catholics. But I'm just going to show you some of the different things here in this book. Let's see here. I'm not going to show this whole thing because it's, you know, a lot of this stuff. I mean, as soon as I'm done with this study, as soon as I'm done with this video, this thing's going and I'm going to be burning it. So, here we go. This is page 13. In general, the powwow doctors specialize in curing physical sickness and injuries through the use of secret incantations and ceremonies. This form of Pennsylvania Dutch faith healing is only possible if the patient believes in God. Absolute total nonsense. Not at all true. Having faith that God will heal you, you don't need incantations and charms. Page 16 says, unlike the powwow doctors, the bewitched people that came to the hex doctors did not have to believe in God, nor in the power of the devil. Once cured of their bewitchment, the patient did not owe his soul to the devil, but was expected to reward the hex doctor with some sort of compensation. If the amount was not to the liking of the doctor, there was always the fear that he might use his power in black magic to make the person aware of that fact. In other words, put a curse on him. Hex books of the Dutch. In the 18th century, it appears that a substantial attempt was made by the Dutch folk to record known formula of both white and black magic. John George Homan of Berks County, his widely popular occult book, The Long-Lost Friend, written in 1819. There it is, right there. Show you in a couple minutes here. Has never been out of print since it was first printed in 1820. This book, although dealing mostly with powwowing formula, gave particular attention to witchcraft. All right. Down here, most hex rite practice was not limited to Homan's formula in later years, but was divided also between two other books, Albert Magnus's Egyptian Secrets, this guy right here. We'll talk more about him as we continue. I'll show you more on this guy. Page 20. According to folk belief, anyone who reads an hex book must reread backwards all he has read toward forward, or that person will be under the power of the devil. Thus, if a person wanted to cast a spell, he could read that particular part of the book and cast it, provided he could reread backwards to keep from becoming damned. In order to break the devil's hold over the reader, the victim must seek the assistance of a powwow or hex doctor. All right. Again, just tell you a little story. I had heard actually of this guy that was into, they said he was into natural health, but also some other things. When in Lancaster County and near Ephrata, out near Ephrata, I think it was towards Hinkletown. And it turned out the guy, they said he was, oh, he's into some, you know, kind of things or a little bit whatever else, you know, a little controversial and things. He was a witch doctor, basically. I don't know if he was Hex or I or Brock or I. I'm not sure. Really doesn't matter. I mean, either way, they're Satanists. But yeah, I knew about a guy in that area. You know, and people, oh, you know, if you can't get cured of certain sicknesses, you know, you check out with old so-and-so, you know, and hey, he'll cure you. And But I find it interesting, too, that they're practicing the thing of backward, reading backward. Aleister Crowley, that was part of his system of magic. Aleister Crowley's right around that late 1800s time period there. But you saw the mention there of Albertus Magnus. And again, I'm going to spoil a little bit here. We'll get more into this as we go on, and I'm going to be doing more videos on this guy in the future. But he was one of only 36 doctors of the church. He's an official recognized Roman Catholic saint, canonized, the whole deal, a saint, Albert the Great, they also call him that, and he's one of 36 doctors of the church. He's a big-time guy in Roman Catholicism, and he's writing books on witchcraft and Satanism and not exposing it, promoting it. How about that? But let's continue. Show you a little bit more here. Page 21. On the other hand, it was widely believed that a possessor of a hex book would gain fortune and be very lucky. In the later issues of Homan's hex book was placed the following memo, which informed the reader that he will be free from all danger if he carries this book here. This print there, but and you see this thing here. And I'll show you that actual thing in the book here in just a little bit. That promise deal. There you have him pointing to a thing. I'm not sure if it's that little one with the thing around it or if it's... I think that's actually a crack in between the two beams there where they're coming together. But it says here, hex letter found in a barn to keep witches out, 1935. Lehigh County. Mercury bags hung in the cow stable to prevent bewitchment. Bearville, 1961, Lancaster County. Okay, these things. And again, you know, I saw this stuff growing up. I saw these things. I saw this type of stuff. Little bags, little cloth bags, you know, hanging in barns and, you know, Amish barns and things. And I was just kind of like, oh, well, I don't know what that is. I had no idea what they were doing. To find evidence of a belief in witchcraft among the Dutch, one must search the rafters of barn roofs, the lintels of doorways, and the less obvious peg holes. Hexerei, being an occult art, cannot be as readily noticeable as a six-foot barn star painted in gaudy colors on a barn front for all the world to see. Okay, now I would agree with that. I would agree that you're not going to see this, you know, these huge big hex signs that they, you know, show on the sides of barns. Just show you here on the back cover of this thing, like that. Okay. That's not necessarily a sign of witchcraft, or hexerei, I should say, the black arts of it. I will say, though, it is evil. Down outside of Intercourse, Pennsylvania, there was actually a old barn that they would sell these hex signs. It was called the Hex Barn. When you're heading out of Intercourse and you're heading towards New Holland, it was down, I can't think of the name of the road, but it was down on the left. And it's since shut down, but I remember that they had problems there and there were fires there and stuff. Doesn't pay you to have these hexagrams, and they're six-pointed stars. They're hexagons. Okay, six-pointed star is a powerful symbol in witchcraft. Again, I mean, this stuff's all over Lancaster County, these hex signs. And it was, you know, again, I did another study with the thing of I had a witch's encyclopedia for a little while, and then Lord convicted me, I burned the thing. And there was definitely some weird stuff going on when I had that. I've told that in other studies, so I'm not going to talk about it here. But they had a whole section on Lancaster County witchcraft. And a lot of the big-name witches, there's one, I forget what her name is. She's some big-name witch. And she has a whole thing on Dutch witchcraft. Hexing and things like that. And I remember, you know, again, got to tell this story. My grandfather, my mother's father, we called him Pop Pop, and he would tell stories. He was from up Columbia area, which is the area of it's kind of the, I guess, the western part of Lancaster County, where it's Susquehanna River comes down in between Lancaster County and York County, and Columbia is kind of the northwestern part of Lancaster County. And he talked about how that there was witches. They were always dealing with witches and witchcraft and things back in his day. And he's like, I guess that's not around so much anymore. You know, no, actually, it's become more mainstream. So now people don't notice it as much because everybody just readily accepts witchcraft in our society today. I mean, it's a very popular movement among the youth. But you go back before the years of, you know, Bewitched and things in the 1960s, the old television show, witches were rightly seen as, you know, ghouls and goblins and evil people. And I'm going to show you some of the practices of witchcraft in that long lost friend. And that's a very revered book among witches too, by the way. I was looking at some of the, I mean, you can look up this thing on Amazon, read some of the reviews, and people are like, yeah, you know, this is a really good book on witchcraft. It's got a lot of good spells on it and things in it. Something. But let's continue reading here, page 23. Hexafooze. To prevent witches from entering the barn to perform evil, farmers sometimes drew or scratched a small five-pointed star on the door frame or sill, hidden from view. Okay? Very, very interesting. Back when my wife, well, I'll just tell you this real quick. I was reading this, and I told my wife about it, you know, because I'm reading this. She's doing her, you know, computer stuff right now and research and things. And we, you know, at the breakfast table the one morning, we were talking, and I said about this. I read that part to her, and she, her eyes got big, and she was like, "Do you remember the house at Gasland?" Down when we were in northwestern Pennsylvania, living down there and helping out with this Baptist church, Country Chapel Baptist Church, and she's like, "Do you remember the place that they had a stand? What was on the in the laundry room there, the door frame?" And I was like, "I don't really remember." She said, "Do you remember that there was some kind of, it was either a hexagram or a pentagram carved into the door frame, very plainly carved into the door frame, not some teenager scratching it on there. I mean, it was very symmetrical, very perfect, carved into the door frame." Weird. And you say, well, it was probably there before, you know, this Baptist pastor and his wife that had the place, they were take they're caretakers of the property. But here's the problem with that. The place where we were staying had been old and run down and falling apart, and they fixed it up. So it was all nicely stained and finished, those door frames. Now, as a Baptist pastor, IFB, you know, the whole deal, as a Baptist pastor, why would you, when fixing up a place, not get rid of a pentagram? I think it was a pentagram or hexagram, doesn't matter. Either one's a symbol in witchcraft. Why would you lovingly take care of that thing and not get it off of there, sand it away, you know, or carve it out of there if you have to? Why would you leave it there? Put stain over it and then finish it real nicely. It's kind of weird. And it could be that they replaced the wood and carved it in there themselves. That's the only two possibilities. Either one doesn't look too good, does it? So, you know, we say, you know, Baptists practice witchcraft and stuff like this. Not too far off from the truth. But show you a couple other things here in this book. Fairhexed horses. They're talking about things there. Animal blood. To keep witches from entering the barn, the blood, both from hogs and cows, was mixed together and smeared over the top of each doorway entrance to the stables. Possessed animals, animals which are possessed by evil spirits and are a constant source of trouble, can only be killed by shooting the animal with a silver bullet. Okay? Yeah, all right. There's carvings on beech trees. Very, very, very common in Lancaster County. Again, Peach Lane, where I was raised. Back when my parents first moved there, there were very few Amish. And when we left, my childhood home actually got sold to Amish. And we didn't know. I would have advised my parents against that at the time. But they bought my childhood home. And but the forest back in, I mean, all the farms in the area were being bought up by Amish and things. And I remember numerous times the beech trees, they have a real smooth gray bark. It's not a real deep furrowed bark, like a lot of like your oak trees or even poplars and things. But I remember seeing weird stuff carved on these trees all over the place, you know, and I was just kind of, I don't know. I didn't really know anything about this stuff. But, you know, there's the picture. It's crazy. A bag of devil's dreck on the lintel of a cow stable. Weird stuff. Witchcraft in the home. Yeah. To repulse a witch. If you suspect a person or being of being a witch and fear that he may do you harm, next time you are in their company, say under your breath, apologize for having to show that, but right there, these are Christians doing this, supposedly. This will certainly make the witch uneasy and she cannot harm you. Hexafoos, a witch star or foot. I thought that was interesting to put on your building and things. Well, I see all these people and they got these big pentagrams on their buildings now. It's a big stylish thing, I guess. Witchcraft formula. Hexerei formula in the Dutch country can be divided into four general areas: protective and preventive, spell casting, spell breaking, supernatural power. Okay, check that one out. Sanctus Spiritus. And you're going to see this in the Long Lost Friend book. You're going to see this where a lot of the charms, a lot of the spells that you cast, after you're done, you're supposed to cross yourself three times. You'll see it. Here you have the next page, page 32. Until that beloved day arrives when the Mother of God will bring forth her second son. I'm going like, huh? This her second son? The beloved day there? Yeah, okay. Next page. To prevent a person to escape, take a needle wherewith the gown of a corpse was sewed. Very morbid. To compel a thief to return stolen goods, three nails out of a coffin, holding these toward the rising sun. There's what you say, this incantation. The three nails, however, must be greased with the grease from an executed criminal or other sinful person. So let me get this straight. The magical stuff that you need to make these things happen, and this is in Long Lost Friend. I'm going to be showing you here in just a minute. They're just showing pages, excerpts from that Long Lost Friend thing. You have to have three nails from a coffin. Where are you going to get that? You have to have the needle for sewing up a dead body. You know, okay, that's a little bit morbid. And then you also have to have the grease of somebody who's dead. In other words, some of their fat that you boil down from a dead body. Good stuff. These Amish are good people to have in your neighborhood, you know. Page 35. And look at this. This is another thing that they tell you to say. And then spake Jesus, "Have not the itch, and no one shall have it. Whoever will assist me to carry the cross, him will I free from the itch. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen." Then spake Jesus. Jesus never said this. So they just make up their own scripture, apparently. Supernatural powers. To cause a witch to die within 1 minute. So you're murdering people. Piercing the heart and killing the witch are facts of the same moment. All will be correct at once, good and approved. Very similar to the Jesuits Reims New Testament, written in 1582, where it talks about killing a heretic, that there's nothing wrong with that. Nobody's going to be held accountable for that. Okay? Now, I know in the Old Testament, there were laws for, you know, the Jewish people, the nation of Israel. Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. You're supposed to execute them. But you're not going to find that in the New Testament. There are witches that get saved. And they turn from that witchcraft thing. And they turn from those sins like that. After their salvation, they say, I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. They get saved. And God helps them to turn away from that wicked past that they've had. You can't continue in witchcraft. Okay? So, there's a witch out there. I'm going to murder her by doing these counter spell, and God's going to be for it. Sure, right. Let's look a little bit more here. Number two, to make oneself invisible. Check this out. You must obtain the ear of a black cat, boil it in the milk of a black cow, then make a thumb cover of it and wear it on the thumb, and no one will be able to see you. Sure, yeah. Cut an ear off of a living cat. How to be able to see in the darkest night. Grease the eyes with the blood of a bat. Number 5. To win every game one engages in, tie the heart of a bat with a red silken string to the right arm, and you will win every game at cards. Yeah, that sounds like a good thing to do. So there you have this booklet, okay? And they're just presenting a little bit of a light coverage of this book here, which I'm going to be showing you now, this Long Lost Friend. This thing here, I read some reviews and they were saying on Amazon that the new paperback editions and whatever else have a lot of the quote-unquote Christian things taken out of them, the three crosses and all this other stuff. And they said, you know, it's not the same as the old editions and stuff like this. So I bought an old edition. This one's printed in 1930, all right? This thing cost us over $100 for this stupid thing. And, you know, but I prayed about this and it was like, Lord, you know, how much should I get into this? And it was just like, I get that feeling like there's something big that you're going to discover with this book. And I did. I did big time. Okay. We have been searching for a long time for a missing link, so to speak, between Lutheranism, the whole Amish system, and the derivatives of Amish, you know, because there's a lot of sects there. But Catholicism, witchcraft, you know, all this stuff. What ties it together? I think there's a lot more to it, but I think this is one of the big tie-ins right here. I want to show you the proof. Pretty incredible stuff. And I'm going to take this fine historic copy, this rare, extremely valuable, you know, there's original ones of this thing, like 1820. I think there was like an original one. It was like hundreds and hundreds of dollars. You know, it's crazy. And older ones or ones around this age are going for $300-$400, you know. And this thing's in really good shape. At least it was before I marked it all up. And then I'm going to burn it when I'm done with this thing, when I'm done with this video. But it's really something. So let me show you. Page 8. Now this is the publisher's historical note here. Talking about back in the early American times, it says they knew their Bibles, and each and every Protestant family had one, as well as a calendar and a catechismus. Okay, a lot of the Protestants, these Protestant families here are just Catholics. That's all they are. They're reforming the Catholic Church. Okay, John George Homan. He claims that his book is partly derived from a work published by a gypsy and partly from secret writings, etc., and justifies its publication by the good that will result from it. Without saying so emphatically, it is rather suspected that the gypsy may have been none other than Albertus Magnus, who or under whose name was published a like work many years before. Magnus was a Dominican monk of the Franciscan order, therefore as an active Catholic, and as such would have had a multiplicity of resources at his command through the archives and machinery of the church. Catholic. Albertus Magnus' works on theology and on arts and remedies were first printed about 1470. The Magnus book bears all the earmarks as the forerunner of Homan's book, title page as well as contents. Thus we suspect that Homan acquired a knowledge of healing by prayer and likewise a copy of Albertus Magnus's Egyptian Secrets in German, and then published his long-lost friend or recipes long kept secret, adding such remedies and recipes as were recommended to him by others or so as it pleased him to offer. Okay? As there was a similar edition published in Ephrata in 1782. Okay, now two things I need to say here. All right. First of all, this book here, Long Lost Friend, that I'm showing you right now, was originally written by a Roman Catholic, one of the doctors, 36 doctors of the church, way back in the 1200s, and it was later published in 1470. All right. And if you look up this guy, and I'm going to be doing more stuff on him in the future, he was into alchemy. And they said, well, he mentioned alchemy, but we don't really know for sure if he was an alchemist or practicing alchemy. Alchemy messed around with chemistry. They were trying to find basically the Midas touch thing, a way that you could make gold out of chemicals, essentially. if you want to get written into it. But it's alchemy is just a fancy way of saying witchcraft and making potions and things like this, which later became chemistry, which later became pharmacopoeia. Pharmacopoeia, pharmakia, is the same Greek word, or is the Greek word that the King James Bible translates as witchcraft. And you get into the study of the pharmaceutical industry, you'll find that it's essentially witchcraft. They're combining all different types of chemicals, horrible petrochemicals, oil-based chemicals. They're combining this stuff all together to make pills to make you better. That's why there's so many side effects with these things, because they're taking toxic chemicals and making them into drugs to get rich off of people that take them. It's disgusting. Albertus Magnus is one of the grandfathers of this movement. He messed around with arsenic and also silver nitrate. Silver nitrate, what is silver nitrate? It is a chemical compound that is used to cauterize wounds. In other words, to burn a wound. And you know what else they use it for? It's what they rub in babies' eyes when the baby's born. You have a newborn baby come out, they take silver nitrate and they will smear silver nitrate on the eyes. Why? Well, because there's a possibility the mother might have had gonorrhea, so we have to be able to protect the baby's eyes. So we got to put silver nitrate. Used to cauterize wounds, okay? And they, I mean, look this stuff up. I'm not joking. They put silver nitrate on the eyes. Silver nitrate goes the whole way back to Albertus Magnus, who was experimenting with this stuff in the 13th century. And it was also, by the way, the Roman Catholics that would use mercury to cure illness. For centuries, they were using mercury to cure illness. And today we have thimerosal. Thimerosal is medical grade mercury. It's a joke. You know, medical grade mercury. It's poisonous. They're putting poisons into drugs and getting people to take them to make the people continually in a state of sickness so that they can always get that money coming in. And the Catholic Church has been expert at, you know, they have researched and studied how to torture people both physically, externally, and internally with drugs, torture you and just enough that you're sick and in pain, but yet not kill you totally right away. They're experts at it. And the full time of this torture, this full Inquisition, is going to be the time of Jacob's trouble. They're going to be torturing just billions of people around the world. They already are through the pharmaceutical thing too, by the way, into the hundreds of millions. But just disgusting. But the second thing I need to mention there, the thing about Ephrata. In Ephrata, there's a commune in there, one of the oldest in America, the oldest Rosicrucian colony. And it's called the Ephrata Cloister. Again, I've been there numerous times. I lived not too far from there. Took my wife there after we'd gotten married and things, and we were still in Pennsylvania. And we went there and showed her around and everything. And they had this thing, the Seventh-day Baptists. And they had a printing system there, a printing press. And they have all these old buildings and things. And these people dressed in all white and stuff. And they had all these weird, kooky beliefs. They had wooden blocks that they'd sleep on. And they would print things in German. You could go into the main Ephrata Cloister building, and they have all these old printed German texts and things, including Long Lost Friend. It's right there. A book on witchcraft. And they have, I mean, it's just the whole thing is just, I have a whole video on the Ephrata Cloister thing. They're terrible, terrible, terrible system there. Benjamin Franklin would actually travel there because he was into the occult. He was an Illuminist, you know, and stuff, and seriously messed up stuff. I mean, it's just incredible. So this book, Long Lost Friend, was published first in Reading, Pennsylvania. It's not Reading. It's spelled like Reading, but it's pronounced Reading if you're from the area. And then it was first printed in Reading, then Ephrata. So, I mean, it's like, I mean, my dad, before he got married to my mother, he was dating a woman or, you know, young girl in Reading. So, I mean, it's just like Reading just up in Berks County from Lancaster County. You basically have Berks County here, Lebanon County, Lancaster County, York County. If you want to get to it, you know, I probably don't have that right. You know, I'm doing it the way I'm thinking here. It's probably backward for you, but you can look it up. But anyways, let's continue here. Further down the page on page 9, the first edition in German is entitled The Long Lost Friend or Devout and Christ-like Instructions for Everybody, etc., published near Reading in 1820. It appeared next at Ephrata in 1828, at the cloister, right there. I know exactly what they mean by that. And it's kind of sick, little inside joke too. I have to add this thing of long lost friend. You know, it's kind of like little inside funny joke there with the Catholics. You know, our long lost friend, they're actually the ones practicing witchcraft. The most powerful witchcraft coven in the world is the Vatican. They're the high priests of witchcraft, and their long lost friend are the people that have the daughters that have strayed away from the Holy Mother Church. So they're going to bring their long lost friends back in through the practices of witchcraft. And of course, you understand in the book of Daniel, it says about the Antichrist will cause craft to prosper in his hand. You know, that he's going to be practicing witchcraft. It's crazy. It all ties together. Page 10. Another at Harrisburg, 1856, in English, and omitting Helfenstein's work entirely reverts to Hillman's original, except that it is faithfully translated into English and with a distinct and notable change. The title page is embellished with an all-seeing eye with three links emblematic of Odd Fellowship, a fraternal organization then growing in favor with the people. Okay, and the next there they print in English, and again in late Lancaster there in 1865, another one in 1912, you know. But Odd Fellows is a Masonic organization. It's like a spin-off of it, kind of like the Lions Club and things, the Rotary Club. Those are Masonic affiliate organizations. So this is page 15. Yet it is not expressly written in the 50th Psalm according to Luther's translation, in the Catholic translation. So this is John Homan actually writing now, and he's referring to Luther, he's referring to Catholic translations. So, you know, and you're going to see as we continue that he knows both Catholic priests and Lutheran, you know, priests. Because they're all working on the same side, folks. Page 16. I could name at any time that Catholic priest whose horse was cured with mere words, and I could also give the name of the man who did it. I knew the priest well. So, Catholic priests performing ritual witchcraft. I sell my books publicly and not secretly, as other mystical books are sold. So by his own admission, he's saying that his book is a mystical book. He sells his publicly, not secretly, like other mystical books. I shall not secret or hide myself from any preacher. I, Homan, too, have some knowledge of the scriptures, and I know when to pray and call unto the Lord for assistance, just as any lost pagan does. You know, don't forget that 2 Corinthians chapter 11 talks about the ministers of Satan appear as the ministers of righteousness. Don't forget that. Down here on the testimonials thing here, page 17, Benjamin Stout, the son of a Lutheran schoolmaster at Reading. So here he's over here he's dealing with Catholics, over here he's dealing with Lutherans. All good buddies. I thought this was an interesting name here. John Baer, son of Jacob Baer, or Bayer, like kind of like Bayern, you know, Bayer Drugs, the largest pharmaceutical company in the whole world. No tie-ins. This is all my imagination. I'm just a crazy man spouting out conspiracy theories and rumors and things like this. It's, mean, I don't understand how people can't see this stuff. I mean, I understand that they're spiritually dead, they're blind and, you know, dead in trespasses and sins, they can't see things. I understand that, but it's just like even from a purely scientific, logical perspective, I mean, there's tying stuff here. You don't even have to understand the scriptures to understand this stuff. It's crazy. But we have page 19 here. This book is partly derived from a work published by a gypsy and partly from secret writings and collected with much pain and trouble from all parts of the world at different periods by the author, John George Homan. So that's what we saw in that pamphlet. They said he wrote that. Okay. Arts and remedies. Another remedy for hysterics and for colds. This must be attended to every evening. This is a real fun one. That is, whenever you pull off your shoes and stockings, run your fingers in between all the toes and smell it. This will certainly affect a cure, I bet. You know? I mean, nice there. And then down here you have to say this, Jesus Christ, dearest blood. And I have there in quote in a, as a question, pleading the blood. And I'm going to do a separate video on this, but just, you know, if you're watching this, you're going to probably see this before the pleading blood thing. But this thing has it all through it. Talking about the blood of Jesus. Say the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood. They don't come right out and say, I plead the blood, but they might as well. They're using the blood for protection, for this, for that, all this stuff. Goes back to an occult book written actually in the early 1300s, or 13th century, excuse me, early 1200s, by a Roman Catholic monk, professor, doctor of the church. So, you know, when you're done watching this video, don't forget, take your shoes off, your socks off, put your fingers in between your toes. And especially the Amish. I mean, good night. Out there, you know, well.